General's Gentlemen.
Hello and welcome to Company of Heroes 2, the wonderful happy place where Americans and Germans kill each other. I guess that was a bit more morbid than what I had in mind. My name is The Machine, and joining me is Mr. Iceman Joker from the RNG Arena. Wie geht es dir?
Mir geht's sehr gut, danke. So, how are you?
I'm alright. I'm feeling good. I said something in German to a German guy, yes!
Yeah, and it was really good. Like, I'm feeling good, I'm really happy to be here again and cast another really good game, hopefully, with you. Yeah, thanks for the invite.
That's really okay. Basically, how it goes, right, is I was like, hey, Blake, want to cast some video games? And he was like, nah, man, I'm at some music festival and now I'm really tired. I don't want to go home. Like, God damn it, Blake. And so, without Blake, rather than having a mental breakdown, I was looking through my Steam list and I was like, who can I cast video games with? Anyway, so this game is going to be Sturm Tiger Giap as our US forces, who's actually locked in his elite rifleman. I think it's elite rifleman.
Yes.
Rifle company, yes. Rather.
Yeah, it's rifle. Yeah, exactly.
Rifle company. It is.
He's facing Jove as the Austere, who also chose a commander, which is
close air support.
Close air support. The wonderfully designed.
My
commander
favorite commander.
Yeah. So fun.
Yes. So this is from last night's tournament, I believe. The Star-Crossed Cup is what it's referred to as, held by Mr. Romeo, the man himself.
This is actually the semi-finals, if I'm right. So, quite important games already. Quite fine to the tournament.
There's so many good games for us to cast. Like we have Lovenest as well. There's a lot of these really top tier players competing. Yep. So pretty hyped for that. And now one thing that's actually pretty interesting that we didn't really mention. Is Jove went for his sniper as the very, very first unit. And the sniper is incredibly potent since the March patch. Personally, I don't like going for the sniper that early, both in this matchup against US and also against Soviets. And the reason why is because if you get it that early, it leaves you very vulnerable to either a fast M20 rush, which is very common for US, or an M3 rush, which can be used reactionary, you know, against seeing the sniper.
Yes,
how do you feel about that?
I agree with you, especially with the counter that the Soviets have. Because if you go for a sniper and the Soviet just spontaneously decides to build tier 1, you have a really big problem, because there's a lot of counter. Like, you can either counter snipe it, or you can as well get an M3, and in both cases you have a lot of trouble with the sniper. Against US forces, it's okay. I like to go it as a whatever second unit, but mostly on open maps only, where I'm sure that I can use it well and I'm not like get flanked and pushed away in the first minute.
It's a nice unit. But the M20, like, it's hard enough to deal with it with regular grins. Adding the sniper into it, I think, can make it a lot harder.
Yeah.
So we'll see if Sturm Tiger Giap does actually go for his M20. Again, generally the pretty standard way of doing it. Can you just pause at 3:30? I turned the music down, which meant that you're probably going to be a bit ahead of me.
Yeah, 3:32.
Okay, all right, 3:32. Are you paused?
Yes, I paused.
All right, we'll unpause. 3:21, unpause. Cool.
Right.
Nothing worse than getting through an hour-long cast and having it like, no one can actually hear what Festive Long Johns is saying because bullets are pretty loud, apparently.
Yeah, well, the thing with the M20 rush, though, is since the 2-2 got buffed as well, I think it's a viable strategy to go sniper and then after that, like, with the free grants or whatever, and then rush the 2-2-2 to have something against the M20. I found myself a lot of players not going for the M20, but for the flag track, because they expect exactly that you go for a sniper and then for a scout car to deal with the M20, so a flag track kind of counters all of that.
Yeah,
we'll see.
I think it really is the map. Because this is a very open map, it means the 222 operates a lot easier. Whereas if you're playing on a map such as Kolodny, where there's a lot of choke points, a lot of shot blockers, the 222 doesn't really work that well against the M20, because what a lot of players do is swap the vehicle crew with the bazooka for rear echelon, and then you can just have the bazooka crew in a high-value garrison, or you can just sort of bait around the corner for a rifle grenade, like the AT rifle grenade from the rifleman. But I think on a map like this, it should be fine. And actually, a 5 tier 1 opening. We've got 4 grens and a sniper, so this is going to be pretty brutal here for Jove.
Yeah, it's really uncommon. Like I normally only go for 4 tier 1 units in this matchup because you want to have tier 2 up early against the M20, which is on the field now as well. So you kind of need a scout card, a pack, whatever, something from tier 2 to deal with it. It's hard to only chase it down or whatever with friends. Although this one is in Faust range now.
Oh wow, he gets the Faust off.
Yeah,
so
there you go.
He can't kill it by any means, but it just means it will buy him some time to either go for the tech or maybe plant some tellers.
Yeah, there's some really good teller spots, especially on the right side, like around the fuel. There's some quite some choke points with a high chance of the M20 or whatever vehicle going through.
Where the barbed wire is that sort of what you're
referring to? Oh,
yeah. That's a good teller spot.
That's one of my favorites, yeah. He has one up over there. Where the wire is, but on top of that, like on the left.
Oh,
left
I see that.
Yeah, there's a teller mine.
So I think that's why we went for the long tier one, but.
Yeah, probably.
You can't really just throw down teller mines and hope that your opponent drives over them, because if they don't, well then you're kind of screwed.
It's too unreliable.
Yeah, unless you sort of have your sniper nearby the teller and you try and bait them over the mine, that can be a good strat to play.
Yeah.
But the M20 really hasn't had that much pressure yet because of that Faust. It's going for the sniper now. There are two Grens nearby.
Oh, yep. Yeah, he just plays it while the save and retreats, but there's nothing in the base that could stop the M20 now. He's not going for it because he obviously doesn't know, but... Yeah, there was basically nothing from stopping him to kill the sniper.
So the tier 1's completed, the tier 2 actually built scout cars coming out, so...
Yeah.
I think that's pretty lucky for Jove that he did actually land that Faust, otherwise he could have lost a Gren squad. For example, at the bottom there's a Gren squad in a house. If the M20 was chasing that one down, it could have wiped it.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's especially with the M20, it comes so early that for Oster it's often just about buying some time until he... got the tools to deal with it. Generally, I'd say you shouldn't shoot a Faust if you don't have a chance to kill a vehicle, but I think in these situations with light vehicles, it's probably viable because you just need to buy some time.
And we do have an M6 mine in our telemine spot.
Oh,
so
yeah.
That's clever as well. I do like that. Really, you know, no matter what faction you are, mining that spot is just really nice to do. And looks as though Jove needs medics really badly. He doesn't quite have the munitions for it, because he actually is going now for his upgun, which he needs the upgun. It's probably more important than his medics, but the infantry engagements are going to be pretty rough for him, unless the sniper's nearby.
That's the thing, at least he has a sniper to do some damage, but otherwise I feel like medics are so important in this matchup, just because you'll have trouble dealing with the infantry. You have only your infantry already, but if it's damaged as well, you're just going to lose every engagement right away.
Yeah, and bleeding the manpower can be pretty rough.
Yeah.
So the scout card
is just chasing around the map, getting every squad on the flank it can find. Chasing off the piles now, and oh, that grand squad is low health. Maybe he wants to ambush it.
He has enough for a Faust, and there we go, that's the field of munitions transfer. Yeah. So all of a sudden, Jove has no shortage of munitions. So we may see more telemines, we may see 9 LMGs, S-mines everywhere. It's definitely a thing that I think is really broken, to be honest, is having that much munitions in the early game is really OP, and it kind of breaks the balance. Having access to such strong abilities that are normally gated behind no munitions.
Yeah, but in my opinion, unless you go for something heavy like an IS-2, it doesn't really get better in the early, in the late game, like the laser strafe, because you have the strafe, which is really questionable as well, especially the AT strafe. It's just, okay, you gotta target it, not like the close air support thing from the Lightning War, but still, it can one-shot American vehicles. It's no.
Yeah, no, I had a game the other day where it literally one-shot a full-health T-34-85. Like, full-health, it was on screen as well, it just one-shot it. Yeah. Other than that, Tundroga GIP, he does have pretty good map control, and that's not really a surprise, given the fact that his US has a very strong early game.
Yep, and I always feel like the US has a really good stance on this map against Austria, especially in this positioning, because the fuel point with the house over there, it's really easy to ambush Grands with riflemen, and I don't know, I think you have a good chance of getting a good early game on this one with US forces.
Yeah, the thing is for this map on Wehrmacht is it's very hard to have both a fuel point and a munitions point.
Yeah.
And that's really what you want to have. You want to have the munitions, you know, for those upgrades, where a lot of factions just don't really need that. Like Soviets and US, I think those are two factions that just don't really need munitions. So often you'll just see them prioritize fuel and not really worry about it too much. Not going to be an issue for Jove, obviously, given that he is the close air support with the transfer. But there's actually two M6 mines down, so keep an eye on the 222, because it may actually get baited into a mine. But look at this, Jove with the minesweeper, he has revealed that original M6 mine.
Yep. Yeah, it's kind of important. It's quite a lot of ammo, even if you don't need it that much as use force. It's still kind of an investment, and you rely on it a bit. The thing with the resources, it would be cool if... if it would be the other way around for Oster, if they don't, if they wouldn't need the fuel that much, but they kind of do, because you can't just play it like in Co. 1 where you just don't get any tanks or whatever and just play it with tier 2. I think that's not really possible.
No, it's really not, because there's just so much potent anti-infantry vehicles.
Yeah.
So
unless you have less support.
Yeah, that's your close air support. So we also have the Flamer Rifleman coming out pretty soon. So going to be good at clearing garrisons, but for now, Jove has held his fuel.
Yeah. He's triple cap though.
Yeah, VP-wise. Yeah, the VPs are actually draining incredibly fast. And look at the sniper. It's got 12 kills. So the sniper is doing very good manpower bleed, and that's pretty much what the sniper always does, especially against US, but the sniper doesn't necessarily translate very well into territory, as we can see as a result.
Yeah. So yeah, that's true.
Jove really has to do something to take this territory back, and yet GF's placing more and more M6 mines. Probably should stop doing that, considering now that there's minesweepers on the field, and the 222 isn't really that much of a threat, especially with the bazooka in the garrison.
Yep. Yeah, and well, he hasn't seen that he's close air support, no, but he could probably expect it. I mean, 2-2-2 and 3 LMGs. Yeah, like, without any munition, like, ammo territory connected, well, it might be close air support. But yeah, the thing with the territory in Austria versus US forces, I think it's in this matchup, it's viable as Austria to even, like, only prioritize the VPs. That's what I do sometimes.
Oh, 22. Didn't take the bait. Pretty sure that was Giab.
There's an LMG grand going down in the north as well.
Oh, I missed that one. Oh wow, LMG's on the ground. The lieutenant gets the LMG. That's brutal.
We got a Thompson, a Bar, and an LMG. Jesus.
Well, what do you want? PTRS?
Yeah. Yeah, well, the thing is, like, you can't have let your opponent have double fuel, obviously, all the time, but it doesn't really... it's not that bad if you don't have your fuel all game, and as long as you have a VP, because it gets easier and easier as longer the game goes for the Austria.
So, just about that M20 play, I'm pretty sure he actually intentionally left it there to take a whole burst of the 222, so that it would try and bait Jove into it. But Jove didn't take the bait, he didn't go over the M6 mine, so either he fished it out, or he was just maybe a bit wary of the bazooka in the garrison.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, maybe that was it. I mean, he saw one mine going down by the M20, so he might have suspected another one.
Yep, so this is the tier 4 Sherm coming out for G-Up.
Yeah, and we have another fuel to munitions transfer for Jove, so he's probably not planning on taking up or anything.
No.
He's getting P-Grand, so I suspect getting Shreks on those.
Yeah, it will be a Shrek for sure with the APAC, and he's going to need that much AT, given the Sherman, it's very, very potent at wiping those squads. And Jove is now pushing back. He has most of the map, and he has some strafing runs available as well. So I think it's going to be hard for GAP to engage in the infantry battles, but the Sherman definitely is going to be able to control the map. And the M20 is still alive as well, bear that in mind. So the M20 can control a VP pretty effectively.
Yeah, and Giap does a really good job by splitting his infantry and taking from a lot of different directions, so the anti-infantry strafe won't be hurting as badly as it could if you keep all the infantry together.
Well, look at the sniper, it may actually die here. Jove, he's trying to... No, he loses it! He was trying to get the cloak. The strafe a little bit too late. It will get the pin, but that Vet 2 sniper dropped, so that's a huge victory there for Giap.
Yeah. Yeah, now he's left with three LMG grants. That's still a lot in BMG, but still, it's kind of depending on that sniper until you lose it.
Yeah, it was a good play because it was actually a pretty long range flank, so there really was no retreat path there.
Yeah, it was well played, definitely.
And look up north, we may see another Gren squad drop. Yeah, the 50 cal gets the Gren wipe, so now there's only two squads of the Grens left here for Jove. Jet really having the infantry advantage.
Yeah, and the Sherman is doing his job as well. Like, you can see Jove was able to push out a little bit, but now he's just getting completely pushed back again. The infantry and the Sherman just push him to the base. He has double AT gun out now, so that will be enough for the Sherman, but he still has to stop all the flamer rifles.
Yeah, that's it. With only three squads of Grens, now a third one coming out. He's needed to have more anti-infantry, because otherwise he's going to lose his packs to these riflemen.
Yeah. Oh, that Sherman got awfully low. I was really close to getting killed. But he managed to get it out of there even without smoke.
What do you think Jap should go for next? Maybe an M8?
Yeah, I mean, an M8 might be good, especially against the Strat. They get some indirect firepower, but the problem is that it's... I mean, you gotta be really careful about it, because it's easily sniped with the Strafe and the Recon run.
Yeah.
So, you gotta watch out for it. But yeah, an M8 might be good. Or I don't know, maybe just another HE Sherman, to be honest.
Yeah, it depends what he's playing for. I think if he wants to go for the VPs, he can just have a HE Sherman on both the North and the South. I think that was just an anti-infantry strafe. Yeah, that was. Yeah, you can just camp a HE Sherman on the VPs, and then Jove can't really do anything about that. Whereas with the M8, he can play a lot more aggressively and try and actually pick off and snipe the packs.
Exactly. Yeah, but with double Sherman, I think if you engage with the infantry and both Shermans at the same time, you have a really good potential of just sheer overrunning your opponent.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's really easy.
Especially if you use the smoke to try and block off the packs.
Yeah.
So we have another field of munitions transfer, so Jove really doesn't want to tech at all. And
yeah, he's committing to that play.
Yeah, he's just spamming out more LMG Grens. Sweeping the M6-9 in the middle.
Whatever happened to the P-Grens? Did he cancel them and get another AT gun? I think that was it.
Yeah,
right?
He must have done.
Yeah.
Probably that's not weird. A bad choice. The P-Grens get wiped rather easily by the HE Shermans.
Yeah, that's true. Although I like P-Grens on this map a lot, because the AT gun sometimes there's a lot of shot blockers, and you can hide P-Grens behind it, while the AT guns might not be able to shot at the Sherman. I don't know.
In garrisons.
I think the
222 that may drop. It's only the HE, so it didn't quite do that much damage.
Oh, and the vet P-Grens with an LMG goes down at the 7 cutoff. And they dropped the LMG.
Wow.
Of these right. Ah, lucky. Yeah, Jovi picked it up. Jove picked it up with his Grens. Yeah. Still, that freeze is important, though.
This is the second time it's happened where I'm watching a vehicle engagement and you're watching an infantry engagement. Good to know that we're keeping tabs on what's going on.
Yeah, it's really good. Like, we don't miss anything.
So it looks like Joe, as GUP rather, may go for the Easy 8. No?
Yeah.
He called it in. Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. It's a really interesting choice. He might suspect some kind of tier 3 or something, but it's interesting because he hasn't seen any tier 3 vehicle yet, and against the infantry, the DIG Sherman definitely is better.
I agree, yeah. I think the Easy 8, I'm pretty sure it's just a lot better against vehicles than the Sherman with the AP ammo, but it doesn't quite have the same AoE with the HE, so it's still good against infantry, and that's mainly due to the 50 cal rather than the main gun. I guess it's a more of a safe option. It won't lend as well to wiping the packs, which I think for him is probably going to be the issue. But I guess he just doesn't really have tabs on how much fuel there actually is on the side of Jove. Even if he goes for a Panther, I mean, that's actually kind of common for this sort of playstyle. Is close air support, field emissions transfer, you have a pretty strong mid game with Shreks and packs and Tellers and LMGs, and then eventually in the late game you go for a Panther to counter the tanks. It's pretty expensive, but you don't really have to rush it because you have a fairly big mid game. But the 222 actually gets taken out by the Easy 8.
Yep, by the Easy 8. What I wondered before is, there we go, the AT strafe coming in on the Shermans, but it's not really anything except that poor house. So what I wondered before is actually against close air support if it's viable to go easy eights instead of normal Germans, because if I remember right, their armor is better, so or their health, so they might be able to survive a shot easier from.
I don't actually know that. Yeah, I'd have to look that up. I sort of assumed that they were the same health and armor, but yeah, I could be wrong.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure. I think so, but yeah.
This is why we need to do live streams, because then we get, you know, someone in chat being like, these are all the stats you ever need to know. Thanks, that guy in chat.
So, oh yeah, he smokes the AT guns. Probably
yeah,
wants to,
he can attack around
him. He's not engaging, but yeah.
Actually, yeah, he's not going for the PAX, rather going for the Grenz. He could wipe this on retreat. It's a pretty dangerous retreat path, but the Sherman's really kind of...
If he would have gotten into that retreat path, that would have been dangerous for the Grenz.
Yeah, I agree. Even if he missed the main gun, the MGs would have probably wiped them. So Jovi's in a pretty rough spot here. He needs to really get his VPs back, but at the same time, he has no territory. M20's going to be denying the point, M20, which is... Like,
yeah, it's shutting down every investment with only infantry squads.
The Easy 8, though. Oh, that last pack shot actually hits the ground.
Yeah, main gun crit as well.
Oh, hits the teller! Oh, he's in a really rough spot now. He probably can use the repair critical. Just kidding, he isn't in a rough spot. He has emergency repair. Jeremy Steps actually on cooldown as well.
Comes Recon run. Yeah, he's probably... The thing is he doesn't have the AT strip available.
Yeah, it's on cooldown. He shoots it down anyway. Where's Kukuma gonna land?
Oh,
he almost wiped the lieutenant. Skill plane kamikaze. That's a reference to a video that hasn't come out yet. Teaser hype.
Teaser.
Iceman knows. He knows what's up.
Yeah, but I'm not gonna tell anyone. Like, my mouth's sealed, right?
Relic level NDA.
Yeah. Oh wow, another straight pink free rifleman. That's the pack. Kind of straight.
There's a three packs. Nice smoke though from the M20.
That's kind of strange. You want to get off of the close air support, like pinning three squads at the same time. It's going to give you a lot of map control.
Yeah, and really that's kind of a mistake there from Giap, is you really just can't blob like that against the close air support.
No, not at all.
That being said, the strafe radius is pretty huge, so like it's actually kind of hard to avoid that though, but yeah.
Yeah, it really is. You just got to really watch out, and the problem is like it's really easy to underestimate the amount of strafes you can spam with that doctrine. Like basically you can, if you want to, you can almost have a strafe and then every engagement because it's so cheap.
Yeah, 60 munitions and with the fuel transfer it's really
it's I don't know, you can have as much as you want. Jove's still not taking up, like I think he's gonna stick to the he's gonna another gren, a fifth gren.
Yeah, I mean, he does have three packs, so he should be fine for AT. But I think...
moving them around together.
I think that's when the inmate's going to come in really handy. But at the same time, Giap can just play the VP game. He doesn't have to kill the
packs. Yeah, that's true. It's also really nice that he has the Phosphorus smoke available. Against the AT guns, it's really good. You can just smoke them with the Phosphorus and then engage with the tanks.
Yeah, like now...
Get wiped. Oh, yeah, right. Look at that.
He's really not quite going in, but you can just
wipe. Oh, the AT Sherman's going after them. You could wipe both squads, it could be huge, man.
It's all the 50 cal. You don't even have to hit the main gun to wipe them.
Yeah, he's going for it. And, Strafe coming in on the Easy 8's going in as well. There's a big engagement. Strafe's coming in.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
Off the skill plane!
Oh, my God. What the hell?
Esports, guys. Don't worry.
Oh yeah, that's an esports classic moment right there. Jesus.
Yeah, but look at that pack though. Oh, it doesn't get the wipe.
Yeah.
Because close air support, because of the strafe, so he did wipe the MG, but he can just recrew that way. Actually no, I did I think the skill plane blew up the MG. Yeah, so he can't get the MG.
I wanna say it's balanced, but it was casualties on both sides with that plane crash, so yeah, at least no one lost his entire army while the opponent didn't lose anything. Still though, this is pretty unnecessary.
And there still is no shortage of tanks here for Giap. He still hasn't the Easy 8 and another HE Sherman with the M20 still. Yeah. So I don't think that loss is really much of a blow there for Giap.
Yeah, well it is for Jove. He lost I think it was a red 3 grand squad. The MG, so
man.
I don't know.
Check it out, I actually caught a squad wipe this time.
Yep.
And Jove throws in the GG, so...
There we go.
What went wrong there for Giap? For Jove, rather.
Yeah, pretty much. Although you have to say Giap played really well.
Oh, he did. Oh, for sure.
Yeah. His infantry play was really good, especially like the moves like the flank on the sniper was well executed.
I think Jove went for the sniper too early. I think that was really it. I mean, the sniper, again, it did well in terms of manpower bleed, but he didn't have any map control, and having that extra Gren squad can really help out, or having an MG instead. And he just lost the map, and when you lose the map, it's hard to really come back from against the US, especially when you don't have any new targets to look forward to. So I think maybe, like, as great as the sniper is, going for 3 or 4 Grens or 3 Grens MG, getting to 22, and then going sniper is probably a bit better way to go. That's at least what I generally do as Osthea.
Yeah, it's definitely more risky to go sniper and then that early. Yeah, if you lose it, you're in a rough spot, that's for sure.
Alright, well anyway, that'll wrap this game up. This is actually a best of 3 series, so we will move on to our second match. Thank you for joining me, Mr. Iceman Joker. And we'll see you in our next match.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me here on the show. It was fun, it was a good game.
Alright.